All right, guys, thanks for tuning in. It's been a little while since I've been on here. Sorry about that. Been in this quarantine and got a baby here by my side. We could be interrupted at any moment. But as long as I look at her and talk to her every so often, then it'll be like, she'll be fine, right? Is that right, Eleanor? You'll be okay? Good. She's grabbing her feet right now. So a reason I wanted to do a podcast is because I like talking about what's going on locally. I like talking about economics and politics and things of that nature. And so this week, there's been plenty of all that going on. As you guys all know, we're all involved in a quarantine right now. And so I've been at home with the kids because they can't go to school and they can't go to the daycare. Chelsea's job, she is working from home, but she still has to go out and make calls and visits and things of that nature. And so luckily, I've been blessed that I'm able to stay home with the kids and use some time off to do that. But it does throw off everything else. It totally throws everything else off. So here we are, Saturday afternoon. I like doing this in the morning normally, but here we are. So whenever you're listening to this, hopefully you're downloading it from wherever you get your podcast. Thank you for doing so. If you're watching this on Facebook, then give it a thumbs up. If you're watching it from anywhere else in the whole wide world, please like and share. Not a lot of people like to hear about Murfreesboro, except people who live in Murfreesboro or live in Rutherford County who are affected by the decisions that Murfreesboro government chooses to do. So anyway, I'm also going to talk about some of our national issues that we have going on right now. And so it should be an interesting show. So I'm looking forward to it and hope you are too and hope you'll stay tuned. If I had a sponsor, now would be a great time to have one. But I don't have a sponsor. So we'll move right in. We're going to jump in. I'm going to start at the local level. I don't know if you guys know about it or not, but Costco is coming to Murfreesboro. And that's a lot of good news, right? Because Costco pays their workers a bit higher than a lot of other places do. And so that's reason to celebrate. And but I do have some issues with Costco and with them coming to town right now. And that issue is that they're getting a lot of breaks that a lot of businesses don't get. The tax breaks that they are getting, they're getting local tax breaks from the IDB, the Industrial Development Board, to come to Murfreesboro. And so we do that, right? And that's the competition that goes on amongst cities and counties as we try to compete to get jobs and people to come. But normally the IDB board does not give money to retailers. They give money to factories and things of that nature, and not to retailers. This is the first time they've done some type of abatement for a retailer. And so an abatement means that Costco won't be paying the taxes that other businesses have to pay, right? So the taxes that we pay for schools and things of that nature, Costco's going to get $1 million cut, saving it right off the top, makes it a great place for them to invest. But they're also getting another tax break. When Trump, a couple years ago, had the tax reform, there's a little unknown thing that he put in there, and I can't remember the word for it right now, but it was a tax break for certain zip codes if you developed in them in certain areas. And so he gave the governor of each state the ability to pick out certain areas of the state that would receive favorable taxing on capital gains. And guess where one of those spots happens to be? Right off of I-24 at the New Salem exit. You'll see that there used to be lots of fields there, green and all that, a lot of farmland. And now it has been plowed down and there's tons of businesses and development going in there. All of that business, all of that development is taking place at that situation. Well, not all, but a lot of it is because of that tax break. It definitely sped up some decisions that were probably going to come into that area. And so now they have that. So that's another tax break that Costco is getting to take advantage of. But the most frustrating thing that has bothered me about Costco coming to Murfreesboro is that they're getting a break on codes. And so we have, when you talk to builders and developers here in town, and I've got friends that are, they say that Murfreesboro is, well, this is a family-friendly show, is not a great place to build, not a great place to develop because we have a codes department that is just sticklers and they're not friendly to work with, and so it's just not easy to build things. But it turns out, if your name is Costco and if you're bringing jobs to the area, somehow you get to work around that. Codes don't matter for you. So normally we'd have, for a retail establishment, they'd have to have so much brick and they'd have to have so much windows and things of that nature. Not Costco. Costco gets to throw up whatever they want, basically. And, you know, so there's that. And I'm, as a libertarian, I'm caught on this, right? Because I believe that if people own the land, they should be able to do what they want with it, right? But it's unfair to other businesses that would be developing here that maybe they don't have the... Maybe they don't have the name brand recognition to get the benefits that Costco's getting. You know, what if mom and pop down the street want to do something like add on to their business? Do you know how much trouble they have to go through to get it to make additions? For restaurants to add outdoor seating has been difficult in the past. And so it's just very frustrating that the planning board, who unanimously approved this plan for Costco, It's frustrating that they don't unanimously improve this for mom and pop businesses. And so you're getting a big tax break and you're getting a big break on codes, and that's just not fair. And so so I'm frustrated with that. It's not the first time I've been frustrated with what planning has done. I think that's maybe that's par for the course in a growing area like Murfreesboro, that people aren't going to be happy with all the growth. But you know, if you're going to have planning and codes, and if you think they're important enough to have, then why not everybody follow them? And if one person gets to not follow them, then why doesn't everyone else get to not follow them? That's the issue here. You know, it's like a animal farm where some animals are a little more equal than others. And that's what we see here locally a lot in our government, is special treatment for some people. And that's unfortunate, and it's not right, and it's not fair. And speaking of, hey there, Eleanor. And speaking of special treatment, that takes me to talk about what's going on nationally. Right now, we have this quarantine that's basically swept across our country and has shut a lot of businesses down. It's really hurt the economy. And, you know, we've got more people unemployed now, as high a percentage as we did during the Great Depression. So the government has come in and has really tried to stimulate things and also make this downturn not so hard on people. You got the $1,200 stimulus payment that's going out to everybody that is approved for it, or they say that's going out. I haven't received one, so we'll see. But also, there's the added benefit to unemployment. So if you're on unemployment, if you're drawing unemployment right now, you get an extra $600 a week for a certain period of time. So that takes your, total payment up to $875 a week, which is higher than what a lot of workers get here in Murfreesboro. That's a very high wage. It's definitely higher than the average that you have here in Rutherford County. And so what that means to those of you out there is that more than likely, unemployment is going to last much longer than it probably would have, because people are not going to take a job and then take a pay cut to take that job. Most of the time, we have found that, we being researchers, have found that people stay on unemployment and don't really start looking thoroughly, really get after finding a job until they're at the very end of their benefits. And so what you're gonna see is that's definitely gonna take place now, like no doubt in that, because it's gonna be very hard for people to find a job that pays more than the benefits that they're receiving. And so that means higher unemployment, longer unemployment, and you know, it definitely means that it's trouble for Trump, because it's hard to get reelected when you've got high unemployment. And so, but that's not all the bailouts that's going on. That's not it. We're also bailing out Wall Street. And so, and that's probably my biggest problem right now, is that we are propping up Wall Street while Main Street suffers. I mean, really does suffer. We've had the PPP plan come out and fall on its face. People have been having a hard time getting that money. Small businesses have a hard time getting that money. Whereas the LA Lakers, and I'm a Celtics fan. And so, you know, the Lakers got this money, but mom and pop down the street, they can't get it. And so, so that's very frustrating. But also the issue here, in my opinion, is that we're bailing out these industries. For instance, the airlines industry. There's a lot of people that are in favor of bailing out the airlines. And I'm not in favor. bailing out the airlines. And I don't think I'm alone either. Chamath Palihapitiya, I'm from Kentucky. I can't pronounce that. But hey, I know it's funny. Eleanor thinks it's funny. But he is a billionaire investor, former Facebook executive. He was on the Scott Wapner show on CNBC, and he came out and said that we shouldn't bail out the airlines industry, and his stuff went viral. I mean, you know, you'll remember that it wasn't that long ago that back in 08, we had the Tea Party rise up, and people were like, you know, why are we bailing out my neighbor who can't afford his house? I'm not getting a bailout. And so now what you're seeing is that we're going to bail out the airlines industries, who has been making a lot of money for the past 10 years. Since we've come out of the recession, the airlines have been doing great. Their executives have been getting paid well. Their employees have been getting small, you know, raises. And their stocks have been going right up through the roof. And I don't know if you've flown in the past 8 years, but the prices have risen a lot, and they're always quick to charge you for your luggage and every other fee they can imagine. And so, very frustrating. And so now they've come upon hard times, right? They didn't save all this money they made. You know what they did with their money? What they did with that money that they made, these extra profits that they've made over this you know, long period, they have plowed that back into the stock. And so it's caused their stock price to rise because they bought more of it. When you it's called a share buyback. And when you buy back those shares, it makes less of them available. And therefore, if you have less of something, you're going to have rising prices. And so they raise the price of the stock as a way to get money back to the people. But they didn't save any of that. They didn't save for a rainy day. They didn't save for a pandemic. I mean, now look, no one really planned for a pandemic, that's for sure. But rainy days do occur. Recessions happen. They do. Every so long, we go through a recession, and that's a cycle, and that is a discussion for another day as to why we have that. And, you know, there are economists out there that have some ideas that you can look up, you can read about, if you want to read Austrian economics, about how to stop these cycles from going up and down and have a more smooth economy. But anyway, we'll save that for another day. But I want you guys to know that if you are out there and you're not in favor of bailing out Wall Street, if you'd rather see some of that money coming back to mom and pop, the people that are really suffering, right? Which, by the way, your $1,200 that you're getting is just like 10 cents on the dollar of what the government is plowing into these publicly traded companies. It's very frustrating that the normal person, the average person, is getting pennies, and he doesn't realize it, right? So the average guy is like, hey, I'm getting 1,200 Trump bucks, and I'm excited about it. But there are lots of businesses out there that are getting a lot of money that they don't really need, and they're taking advantage of it, and that's unfortunate. It's really, really unfortunate. For instance, if you own your own business, and a lot of people do, they base the amount of PPP that you can get up off your profit. And I know a lot of business owners who employ lots of people. And then at the end of the day, they don't make a lot of money. And so if you didn't make a lot of money, you're not getting a lot from the PPP. And so therefore, too bad for you, you know, which is awful. So again, what we're seeing is, you know, what we see all the time, that those that have the most money are able to go to DC, they're able to lobby, and then they get the most of the pie. And it's unfortunate. And, you know, our congressman, Scott Desjarlais, where are you on this, man? You know, you're bailing out Wall Street, and you're not bailing out Middle Tennessee, and that's frustrating. You know, the other thing I wanted to touch on nationally is that I'm excited that Justin Amash, I think that's how you say it. Again, I'm from Kentucky, so I may not know how to pronounce words properly, but Justin Amash is running for president as a libertarian. You'll remember that Justin Amash is from Michigan, and that he's a former Republican. He went against Trump during, you know, he backed out of the Republican Party because of he got in trouble for wanting to impeach Trump. And so he left the Republican Party. He was independent for a little bit, and now he has decided to run for president. And as a libertarian, I like the idea of the guy running for president. He's not a guarantee to get it. We still have to go through the nomination process and things of that nature. But he's a highly talented individual, and I'm pulling for him. I'm hoping that he gets it. And then I'd love to see us provide more choices to the people. If you're not happy with Trump, you don't have to vote for Biden. There are other people out there. Jesse Ventura is also looking to run. He's from Minnesota, thinking about running on the Green Party ticket. And so that could be really good. I don't have a problem with giving people more choices. We have lots of cell phone carriers to choose from. So, you know, and what has that done? That's made it better for us citizens. It makes our cost lower and makes these people compete. And you're able to get a better product in the end. And so I think the same thing will happen if we allow these guys to run for president. And if you give them a fair shake and you listen to them and then vote your conscience. Don't feel like people tell me when I vote for a third party that I'm throwing away my vote. You're not throwing away your vote. You're voting your conscience. You're voting the way you think what is best. The only way you can throw away your vote in the United States is by not voting. And so I hope you remember that. And go out and vote and take other people to the poll with you as well. And give everybody a chance, man. You could still be for Trump. You can still vote for Trump. You can still be for Biden. But just give these other guys a listen. And then when you walk in, don't fall for the old ploy that it's a duopoly and that a vote for someone is a vote for someone else and all that jazz. Pick who you think is best, who you want to be president, and vote for them and believe in your vote and believe in the power of one vote. So speaking of one vote, you know where your vote really matters? That's in local politics. And so going forward, I'm going to be interviewing a lot of people, at least I'm hoping to, interview a lot of people that are running in the races coming up. We've got, I got my list on the back of the envelope here. We have in the Congress, I believe that there's some competition for, I think we got someone that's running against Desjarlais, I think. I'm not sure, I have to double check that. But I know that on the Democrat side, there's Noel Bivens and Christopher Hale, who I've interviewed before. Looking forward to speaking with Noel and Christopher. Hopefully they'll come on the show and talk with me. And then also, so that's for Congress. Then we step down. Then in Senate, we've got a Republican-Democrat matchup. You got Shane Reeves, who's also been on the show before, and Chase Clemens. Look forward to talking to them, hearing how they're talk about. Then State House, we've got Mike Sparks going against Brandon Thomas. Going to be an interesting race there. Brandon Thomas is part of the group that, have you heard about the guy from Memphis that got booted out from the Democrat Party? I think Brandon Thomas played a role in that, so that'll be interesting to talk to him about that. Then Brian Terry is running against Matt Ferry. I think Matt ran against him last time. A very interesting race, in my opinion, will be against Charlie Baum and Mariah Phillips in the 37th District, which is where I used to live. I'm friends with both those guys, and so it'll be interesting to see how that plays out. And then Tim Rudd, who is my current TN House representative, has a competition against Mary Vaughn. And so I think that's right. And anyway, I'm looking forward to talking to all them, bringing them on the show. We've also got local elections. We have a circuit court judge in Tennessee. We elect our judges. We got Joe Atwood going against Jack Mitchell. Hopefully I'll be able to sit down with them and talk to them why it's important that you guys are able to choose a judge and things of that nature. Then we've got some school board positions that are up. I'm very excited about Claire Maxwell, who has thrown her hat in the race, and she's going against Terry Hodge. You've got Rick Creasley and Lisa Moore going against each other, and Howard Jones, that's in the 3rd District. And then in the 2nd District, you got Patrick Doty going against Coy Young. So look, there's a lot of battle going on in these school boards. They are nonpartisan races, but there is definitely some partisanship going on. It's going to be fascinating to see how these play out. I look forward to talking to all of them. And then last, but definitely not least, the city council here in Murfreesboro. We have an election coming up with city council. There'll be 3 seats up, and thank God there are 4 people running. I thought I was going to have to jump in there because there's nothing worse than there being a race and people not getting a choice in the matter. So for city council, we've got Bill Shacklett, an incumbent, Eddie Smotherman, an incumbent, Kurt Wade, an incumbent, and then Sean Wright, who has run before in the past, running for city council. And so 4 great men that I look forward to speaking with and talking to and sharing why they're running with you guys and finding out more about them and just giving them a chance to talk. And, you know, in this race, you know, this is going to be an interesting interesting political season. We've got this COVID-19. I don't know how it's going to play out. And right now in Brazil, it's spreading like wildfire. It's warm in Brazil right now. And so everybody's been counting on the summer to help us with COVID-19. And I just don't know how much it's going to help. And how is that going to play into local politics in the fact that it's going to affect how you campaign? And I think that it's going to make shows like mine and other Facebook outlets far more important in the campaign, because people are going to have a hard time getting in front of the public and asking for their vote. And so I look forward to interviewing them. You know, I'm really going to try as best I can to be as Walter Cronkite as possible, you know, like Bob Woodard style, right, where I try not to be friends with any of these guys and ask them hard-hitting questions. You know, I want to ask them some tough questions, tougher questions than I've asked in the past. I've been doing these interviews for a while now, and I'm really ready to dive in and try to do some journalistic reporting for you guys, for my listeners out there. I appreciate all of you, and thank you for tuning in this week. Hopefully, I'll be getting a schedule out to you guys as far as on my Facebook page and on my regular website, so that way you guys can see what's going on, when these are going to be interviews are going to be occurring. I'm excited about it. I hope you are. I hope you're staying safe out there. We have opened up Murfreesboro the way I understand it. Maybe I'll be able to get a haircut soon. And so anyway, I hope you guys found this show enjoyable. Thank you for tuning in. Please like, share, leave a review on iTunes. You know, it's good for you, right? And it's good for the show, and it's good to get other people to listen. If something's going on in Murfreesboro and you want to talk about it, or if you'd like to talk about any of these issues, please go on Facebook, find me. I'm not hard to find. Tweet me up on @AnswerFancher, and I'd love to talk to you or talk about the subjects that are important to you. Thanks for tuning in. Look forward to talking to you next week. Bye.